Hello and welcome to Know Your Startup, a VC Circle podcast series. I'm your host, Joseph Rai. In the Know Your podcast series, we speak to the founders of startups across various sectors about their journey, not just from a business, but a human perspective as well. In this edition, we have Satish Kannan, who's the co-founder of online doctor consultation startup, DocSap, which is backed by venture capital firms such as Bessemer Venture Partners and Rebright Partners. DocSap was recently in the news when it merged with the Bengaluru-based digital consumer health business of Medibuddy. The merged entity also got a big Series B check. Hi, Satish. Welcome to our podcast and thank you for joining us.
Hi, Joseph. Thank you for inviting us. Look forward.
Before we talk about the merger with Medibuddy recently, which created quite a buzz, tell our listeners briefly, what is DocSap and the problem it is solving?
In India, actually, the access to good quality healthcare is a big challenge, right? So I briefly worked at Philips Healthcare, so spent a lot of time with doctors, hospitals, operation theaters and all of them in the cardiology and the ortho division. So spent a lot of time with doctors in the heart and let's say related areas. What we generally see is the number of specialist doctors in the country are very, very few. And some of the best healthcare infrastructure is all in the big cities. So the access to good quality healthcare, access to a specialist doctor is always a challenge. And that was the intention, that was the idea with which we started out, to make high quality healthcare accessible to a lot of people. And the only way to do that was through the digital medium. Because once I thought that let's build hospitals across the country, but it's very difficult to do that because infrastructure wise, very costly, but more importantly, very difficult for us to get doctors also to move into all these small towns. So that is essentially how we got the idea behind using a digital platform that connects patients with all healthcare services very easily. So today on, now that you're coming together, today on Medibuddy DocSap, you can do many, many services. Mm-hmm. You can talk to a doctor online through a chat, a call or a video, which has become all the more important in this COVID times. But after that, you can also book appointment, go to meet a doctor in the offline hospital, get your medicines ordered and get it delivered at your house. And you can also get your lab test booked on the platform. So it's a one-stop healthcare platform, accessible digitally, and you will get access to all kind of services for your healthcare needs for yourself as well as your family member. So that's the whole idea with which we started, and that's what we've been continuing to scale now.
Okay, cool. Interesting. So we'll go back a bit in time. So you founded DocSap in 2013 with your colleague, N. Bashekar D. Both of you were batchmates at IIT Madras, I believe. How did the two of you get together and decided to start DocSap?
Yeah, so both of us actually met at IIT. So we were sort of classmates, like roll numbers, right? Next roll number, I guess. And in the hostels, we were actually the next room or one after one in the room. So we sort of know each other from the college days. And we had a lot of interest in doing things in technology, right? So at IIT also did a lot of projects. I did a lot of work with a lot of internships and companies. And we had, by the time we had graduated, we had built a lot of solutions in the healthcare space, primarily for projects and work that we had done with other hospitals as part of the collaboration with IIT. So by the time we were graduating, we were sort of clear that we wanted to do some work in the healthcare space. And we wanted to do something in the intersection of healthcare and technology. So that is sort of how we got into this. And so when I graduated, I took up a job in Philips Healthcare. And Inba actually got a job in Qualcomm. But Qualcomm was not healthcare, right? So so we didn't join Qualcomm. So Inba joined another healthcare company in the diabetes space. So I left, I worked for some time in Philips, Inba worked for some time in the diabetes company. So they do a lot of work on a disease called diabetic retinopathy. So if you have diabetes for a very, very long time, it can potentially affect your eyesight.
Okay.
So he was working on that technology that is actually used in identification. And so I left Philips, and then he left the diabetes company, and then that's how we started out.
When was that, you know, particular moment both of you said, okay, let's do it, let's take this plunge?
See, generally, it is not like a one moment, but you have been thinking about it for some time, all through the time when we were working in all of our places. Because I spent I used to spend like all weekends, like Saturdays and Sundays in the hospitals, talking to doctors, understanding what they do. So it's sort of a gradual understanding that, like I told you, we had a broad interest that, okay, healthcare is a good area, let's work in healthcare. What exactly would we build? What would be the right product? All of this is like a matter of time. But what we saw was, when I was working at Philips, a lot of doctors started using, this is 2013-14, that time. WhatsApp WhatsApp had just started. Okay, it's not like so famous that time. And doctors used to actually use WhatsApp to discuss as well as send or receive X-rays, reports of blood test reports, because otherwise somebody would have to come from somewhere else and give you the X-ray, right?
Right.
And it is called as angiogram. So there's a small video. And all of this actually was sent on WhatsApp. That is sort of might be the initial trigger point for us to understand, oh, doctors actually need a solution like this, which will help them to interact and get information from a customer or from a patient here, or send it to another doctor, right? They're doing a lot of collaborative work, but through WhatsApp. So that's also some of the clear understanding that a technology solution around that area might be needed.
Okay.
And that is how all of this started. And Inba was actually working on, I didn't talk so much about it, but Inba was working on an area called teleophthalmology.
Okay.
So in ophthalmology also, you need, because they could not have good ophthalmologist doctors everywhere, a technician would take an image of your eye. It's called fundus image. So he takes that, and then that is transported to the main center. So he also understood how softwares are needed to do transmission and all of that.
Okay.
So that's a gradual way. And then in 2015, actually, we launched Doxam, and then continuing to help as many patients now.
Okay. So what was your family's reaction to it, the first thing, when you said that you wanted to become an entrepreneur, startup?
Generally, people are worried, right? You're doing a good job. You want to get like a very good school. So, and you got like a really good job. You can continue in doing that. So that is there, but of course, it took some time, but they were broadly okay with it. They told, okay, do something.
Okay. that's interesting.
Initial days might be tougher, but you should continue to keep doing it. And then with time, you'll actually identify what are the real problems in the business and how to build it out, and all of that will happen.
So how did you manage to get your first set of individual investors, you know, to kickstart your project? Because every project, every startup requires capital. How did you manage to cobble together a capital to start up initially?
No, actually, that is one of the places where sort of IIT helped. I think now there are a lot more angel investments happening, VC investments happening, and a lot more incubators have come up, right? So for us, because we were, so after I left IIT, worked at Philips, when I came back, I went to IIT. So my college. So there used to be a incubation cell. So what happens is people who have ideas can come to IIT, and IIT would sponsor you some capital. So the first investment that I got was like 5 lakh rupees. So that was the sort of like the first investment. And that was done by IIT. So IIT Madras has an incubation cell, and they support many companies like this. And they also would give you some office space and all of them. You can work out of their office. Actually, now I think there are some hundreds of companies which has been sponsored. I think if I'm correct, I'm like the first company. The first company which graduated from the IITM incubation cell. So the first investment came from there, but then after that I actually went and met this accelerator. Like I told you, incubation accelerators are there now. There are many, but at that time I think there's only one or two at that time. It is called GSF Startup Accelerator.
Okay.
So these are all a group of prominent people from the industry who come together, and it's a group called GSF, and they also identify good companies and invest in them. So that's sort of how my early investments happen. After that, we continue to keep growing from there.
Okay. So later you raised an institutional round of funding. So you raised seed round from Rebrite Partners, and then later on Series A from Bessemer Venture Partners, besides some other Japanese investors. So, you know, how tough was it to sell your startup to them? Any learnings that you would like to share, especially, you know, to others, you know, who are raising seed money or pre-Series A money now?
Okay, so I think raising capital is it varies with time, right? Varies with the stage of the company that you are in. So when you're very early, let's say the first investment that I had done with GSF itself was small, but all of them sort of happened on a team, right? At that time, there was no team. I was there and Inba was there. So two people. So that's always what you can see. But of course, they could understand that they had some understanding about healthcare and all. So might be the very early angel investments are purely based on the team. And even the sealed round is sort of team. But by the time we had actually used some capital that we had and did some prototypes. And we had also done some market testing by that time. So broadly, I would say initially the very early days will be team. And after that will be some working product. It can be product, it can be service, it can be technology, whatever that be. And the stage after that is called as product market fit, in the sense, which is mostly by the time you do Series A. You need to, so when you are getting investment from Rebrite, we already had the product, it was working, customers liked it. Now, how will the business model work? All of that had to be, we had some very basic idea on that one, but then we start building on that. And that is when Rebrite Partners invested. And by the time Bessemer came in, we had actually got a business model, we were making revenue. It was sort of very clear what the product is. And after, so that is like another thing. And after Bessemer came in, of course, then you start looking at how do you continue to grow your business, right? Initially, you understand that a very small set of customers are coming, they're making payment. Our business model works around payment, right? It can be different businesses will have a different model. Content businesses will have some other metric. For us, it was more like how many patients are coming to a platform, how many of them are utilizing and talking to a doctor and all of that. And then I think Bessemer invested. And after that, we have been growing from, we added many lines, right? So you talk to a doctor, then you can get your medicines, you can get your labs, then you grow your geographical reach. So that's sort of the journey from the team to a very basic working prototype, to a product market fit, to business, to scale.
Okay. So when Bessemer invested in your Series A funding round, I'm sure there were other term sheets also you might have considered, right? Why did you finally select in the Bessemer Partners, Venture Partners?
Yeah, so broadly because of, because Bessemer, if you check their background, they have a lot of interest in the healthcare domain. And both their US, the US holding also has got a lot of investments in health. Health is a very big focus for them in the process, in their evaluation. And in India also, there are many, many health-based investments or healthcare companies. So the understanding about the ecosystem is generally far better. And they understand how the complexities, good and bad, right? Of all, every industry will have its own challenges, right? The kind of challenges, the kind of intricacies are different. And Bessemer was actually very good. So at that one. And then I was chatting with Vishal, who's also the MD. And so I sort of really liked it. So how we were thinking about it long term, right? It's very important that most of these businesses are built over very, very long terms. If you think about hospitals, no? Generally, you can't start open a hospital and like exactly 1 month from the day you open the hospital, you can't become a big hospital. Generally, it doesn't work that way, right? But you can actually become a big electronic shop, right? You can actually do that. So some businesses take some amount of time, not a lot, but 2 years, two and a half years actually to actually really make a difference. So that was sort of links things very long term also. So I think that sort of helped us. And then that's how out of I think some of couple of them, three or four of them, we took. We I think really like this one. Okay. Cool. And they also like both ways.
Right.
I think it's both ways.
And yeah, I think they're confident in your business. They let your series B round also recently, right?
Yeah.
So I wanted to talk about the merger with Medibuddy. You know, what triggered this merger? Who approached whom? How did this happen? If there's some anecdote you want to share.
No, so fundamentally, see, I think we're all partners in the industry, right? I think all of us sort of work together. We know each other. We have been working. So the core focus continued to be that on DocsApp, a lot of our customers came from very, very small town. So we have like 60% of our customers coming from. So all of us are direct customers, right? Customers who come directly install DocsApp on Android or iOS or come to the web platform and then make payment out of their own pocket and use the healthcare services. That's sort of the full model. And we had close to 60% of them coming from very, very small town because access to healthcare is a very big problem. I mean, in cities, it's more about a convenience problem. And in the small town, it's a access problem. And we had also built out our solution in multiple languages. It is available in Hindi. It is available in multiple. You can talk to doctor in like 16 languages. So this is sort of the background about what we actually were doing at DocsApp. And Medibuddy also was doing very similar in the sense they also provided access to doctors, then access to medicine, access to healthcare. Their customer base, or they were primarily concentrating a lot on the corporates. So if you're a large company, because you want to provide health benefits to your employees and your partners, you would provide what is called as healthcare, health benefits to their employees, right? So that was done through Medibuddy as a platform. Okay. So, and then we are in the ecosystem, so we keep chatting, we keep talking and all of them. But then when you understood that, when you like continue to keep scaling, it is important that we come together so that it's complementary in nature. We help a lot of customers in a very, very small town. They help a lot of customers in the big cities. And at the back end, we work with the, actually, it so happens that we work with the same set of doctors, same set of labs, same set of pharmacies, a lot of them. So it's called network. So now today, I think coming together also what happens is it increases the scale. It increases the customer base. It also increases the network. Okay. So today we have network across 95% plus PIN code percentage of the PIN codes in the country. And we help, I think, together we help around 25,000 patients every day. And that's significant. Okay. And of course, in a way, we're very happy also that coming together helps a lot more people get good quality healthcare. So that is the whole idea with which we thought, okay, it will be great to work together and provide a complete set of services, right? So they had a lot of doctors in some places. We had a set of doctors in some other places. They had some labs. We had some labs. So I think when it comes together, any PIN code you take, now we will have access to doctors, hospitals, and diagnostic centers, labs, and all of that. So that's the whole idea with which we sort of thought about coming together, and then I think we brought it together.
Do you see more of these mergers happening, especially in the online, you know, doctor consultation space, given the fact that a lot of them said that, you know, they've seen a lot of traction during this lockdown period? Do you see more of such deals happening?
Okay, so there's actually two different things. One is growth, right? Growth happens primarily because companies are doing well, also because market is sort of exploding now because COVID has happened. So very difficult for people to really go offline and go meet a doctor. It may not be safe also. It's better that they stay at home and then talk over video. So that's the one. Businesses or the market or digital ecosystem has significantly grown. And all businesses have grown very, very fast. All the digitally enabled businesses have grown like significantly fast. So that is one part of it. See, generally in all ecosystems, as it matures, as it scales, consolidation generally happens. So if you have seen in a lot of, let's say, previous companies would have been in e-commerce space, right? Like in 2007 to 2010 to 2011, I think by 2012 is when Flipkart started becoming very, very big. But for the first 4, 5, 6 years, there are many, 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 many companies, right? In the e-commerce space, it can be Flipkart, it can be many, many of them. So over time, generally what happens is people continue to keep working together and scale. And consolidations generally happen in large industries. And over time, there'll be like one player, might be two players. So like you can see, right? So now the whole e-commerce is now between, let's say, Flipkart and then, let's say, a new entrant from external is Amazon, right? So that's the model. And then you can see that in food delivery also. There used to be a lot of food delivery companies. Now I think it is sort of one, two people, right? So Swiggy and Zomato. Similarly, I think consolidations generally happen in all industries. Might be healthcare might be, I'm not sure whether it's the right time, but now is actually a lot of time for growth. Maybe 12 months, 24 months from now, potentially there are opportunities.
And if I were to ask you, what is the larger plan for DocSap? What would you say right now? What is your vision?
Yeah. So our vision continues to remain the same. Like I think we keep repeating, but the idea is, see, what do we really, really care about? The only number or the only thing that we really care about is how many patients are able to reach out and access good healthcare advice, right? A doctor might give you the right advice, or a psychologist will give you the advice, or a dietitian will give you the advice, right? It can be any medically relevant advice. It can be for preventive care also, right? If you don't want to fall sick, you can go to a doctor. But in turn, if you're talking to a doctor and getting advice on how to do your diet, how to take care of your health, how to do exercise, how to do yoga, all of them. So all of this also falls in the preventive care, right? So the whole idea is, how can we touch the lives of a lot of patients on a daily basis? That's like a clear number that you, that's why I keep saying 20. So when I started, I will tell you, right? When we started DocSap, we used to wait, and we used to get one patient in 4 days.
Okay.
So because nobody knows you, right? So
right.
Many of the days people don't use it, right? People don't know you. It's a very small company, right? We used to get one patient in 4 days. I think now, so that's like a clear metric that I keep tracking. So today, I think we are able to help 25,000 of them on a daily basis. And the next stop will be at around 100,000 patients every day. So we should be able to touch and improve the lives of around 1 lakh patients on a daily basis. And that's sort of a clear metric or clear thing that we really aspire to and then grow from there. And then why that's also relevant is because, see, if you look at the largest hospital chain in the country, right? It is Apollo Hospitals. Now I think maybe there are two, three of them. But if you take even the largest player, they would be helping maybe 15,000 patients a day. Give and take, might be in the range, 12,000 to 15,000. So a large hospital group, because once upon a time I wanted to build hospitals, right? So the large hospital group of, they have 70 hospitals, 40,000 employees, so many of them. It's like very large. Right? So this whole, the whole hospital chain helps only 15,000 patients a day. So it's very difficult to actually build a system that can help like 100,000 patients and potentially like 10 lakh patients a day, right? And we are potentially able to do that because of the power of technology, right? Power of technology. And it also got accelerated because of COVID. Might be otherwise it would have happened in, let's say, 7 years, but now it would have happened, it will happen the next potentially 2 years, right? Because people have understood that it's digital. So the whole idea is that, and then helping a lot more patients every day is the main goal at Medibuddy DocSap. And our intention is purely at that.
So is the aspiration to become the next unicorn also there on the back of your mind as a team? How much do you think about it? Or, you know, you're just more focused on your work?
Fundamentally, how I think, or we all think, is, see, I'll be more happier if 1 billion people got healthcare from Medibuddy DocSap, right? I think that is more important. I mean, unicorns are okay, but accessing service is very important, or providing service is very important. And that is what sort of we think about every day. We're not so worried about, or we don't think so much about valuations.
Okay. And what has been the biggest hurdle for you as an entrepreneur?
So I think there is, it's sort of like a journey, right? When you start, you have a different kind of problems. See, when we started, we were actually 2 people, right? Today we are like 1,000 people, correct? So the kind of work that I have to do is very different, right? So the initial set of challenges are different because you're 2 people, you don't have a team, you're doing like everything. In fact, we didn't have an office also, right? So we used to operate out of my professor's lab. So he had a lab, and in the lab, he had a room. which is for the conference meetings and all of them. So you told, we were like disturbing him in the live, you told go sit in the conference room. So that is how we got our first office. But of course, I think now today we have like offices in 25 cities, right? So the, I think at different points of your journey, you will have different kind of challenges to overcome. Some can be identifying what is the right product, what is the right business, how do you scale the business, how do you hire a lot of people. From two people, you have to go to 1,000 people, right? So you have to hire a lot of people, then you have to manage the team, you have to ensure that experience is good. So all of them, this is called a scale, right? And then initially, there used to be one office, right? Everybody is in the same office, under the same roof, everything's easy. Now I think we have some multiple offices. So all of these are what you call us, and I would not say that it's very big, right? I think you're all getting started. It's day one. I think we've just touched around 25,000 patients. So I think it's a really, really long time to go, or long way to go. Challenges keep, let's say, changing as time progresses. And it's important that we look at it one step at a time and keep innovating and keep improving. And keep the customer in mind. Whatever is necessary and right for the customer, please keep doing it. That is the only answer to all the problems.
So an entrepreneur's life is said to be very, very hectic. How do you, you know, maintain your work life in a balance? Do you have a life?
No, definitely. See, the whole idea is, I think generally it gets hectic, but then you'll also sort of learn around how to actually manage a lot of these things. Of course, I got a lot of support. I got a lot of things around me which helps me in managing my time, my car, all of that is taken
care. Who's your biggest support system?
No, it's one is essentially family. But if you're looking from an operational item, I think there's a lot of things around me, right? I think there's somebody to take care of a lot of these activities are all done by somebody else. So I think it just helps me get a lot more time. See, the whole idea is, the way is, I think everybody has 24 hours. I think that we all know, right? You can be the prime minister of the country, or you can be Jeff Bezos, or it can be Mukesh Ambani, right? Everybody has the same amount of time. So it's not like the prime minister has more time or you have the less time, right? At the same time. So now it's about how do you actually sort of manage your time. And initially it's very tough. Actually, I mean, even now it's very tough. But you sort of get around how to sort of manage your time and what kind of work you can delegate. Because you can't do everything. So you'll actually identify different team members. You delegate a lot of this work. And then you keep looking at the next set of things to be done. So that's sort of how sort of it gets going.
Okay, cool. And what do you think COVID-19 and the lockdown has taught you?
Yeah, so a couple of things are very, very relevant actually in this context, right? So maybe some of the keywords would be, it teaches you to be super agile, right?
All right.
And it also actually forces you to be very innovative, right? You have to be agile and flexible, and also innovative in the way you think and you operate, and speed of execution is very important, right? The whole COVID happened, the pandemic is happening as we speak. So what has happened is a lot of good things has happened, which is essentially a lot of solutions are accelerating to digital. So in a way it is positive. And which is helping a lot more people without having to really go offline in the process. But another thing is, a lot of doctors and hospitals are also starting to adopt technologies faster. Earlier, they're just a little slow because there's no other way, right? A doctor and a hospital has to adopt technology. And government is also very supportive. Earlier, the regulation was not so clear. We used to talk about telemedicine guidelines in 2014 and 15. Right. But the day COVID hit, I think 1 week from them, everything was, regulation was right.
That's right.
So in a way, the ecosystem has helped a lot. To behavior change has happened very fast. What would have taken, Flipkart took 2017, 2007 it started, 2008, but 2020 everybody buys online.
Right.
But it took 13 years for that to happen. But in the case of COVID, you talking to a doctor online might look like very new in the beginning days. But exactly 2 years from today, instead of becoming 10 years, now COVID has compressed the time, right? So that's sort of the key learnings from COVID. And in a way, we're all learning a new set of things about how, initially, I used to think I have 25 offices. Now you have 1,000 offices. Why? Everybody's house is an office, right? So he will have its own challenges. If you don't have internet in your house, then you can't answer the customer calls. It's very complicated. Right? So I think these are all things that we learn, but it has ensured that all of us become very innovative, and they call this it right. Necessity is mother of invention. So in a way, you don't have a choice. So you will like sort of innovate around it and identify the solutions for all the problems. So, but it's very important to be solution focused. You should not think about a problem more, but you should think more about, okay, now that this problem is there and it is not going to go away, because COVID will take its own time. So how do you work around it?
Okay, thanks, Satish. It was great talking to you.
Thanks, Joseph. Nice talking to you. Thank you for your time.
Yeah. So that's all we have in this edition of Know Your Startup. Thanks for listening. Take care and goodbye.